So welcome to everybody. Welcome to this first of the 2017 Season Distinguished Speaker Series. We're delighted to welcome Lloyd Dorfman here today, who's going to talk about the challenge of building a challenger business. I just want to get a sense of how many of you are 25 or younger? Okay. If I get my math right, Lloyd was 25 when he founded what we know to be TravelX. So you still have a few more months. So what we're going to hear about is the story of the creation of TravelX, but not just that business. He's also chairman and majority shareholder of the Office Group, as well as the chairman and founder of Dottl. So we're going to hear about all of his various business ventures. I could go on about the various philanthropic activities which he is deeply involved in, the awards that he's won, but I think it's probably best to hear from the man himself about the work that he's done and his adventures and in the challenge of building challenger businesses. So with that, Lloyd Dorfman. Thank you, Lloyd, for returning
to
school.
Thank you very much. So, Peter, thank you very much. And it's a great pleasure to be here today. Last time I was here, actually, was to do a sort of similar sort of thing for Peter's predecessor, Colin Mayer, who I was actually at school with many years ago. By the way, it was 24 when I was 24 when I started the business. And I didn't. I did go to school, which is a helpful start, but I didn't go to university. Which somehow I managed to survive. But I am an honorary fellow of St. Peter's College, Oxford, which is a very nice association, which actually goes back through my late father-in-law, who in turn got involved with St. Peter's because he became very friendly with its then very distinguished master, going back, this is in the late 60s, early 70s, very distinguished economist called Alec Cairncross. So today I'm going to sort of talk about the challenge of building a challenger business, and really I'm going to talk about it through the lens of, yes, TravelX and a number of other businesses which I'm involved with. Peter's already mentioned the Office Group, the flexible office business I have, and I'll talk about that. And also Dottl, which is really a sort of click and collect business. And I think really the interesting thing about the sort of those businesses is how they reflect sort of the pace of change and the way we do things differently now much more quickly than we, or things change, the pace of change has increased so much over the years. I'll start with the TravelX story because that's the sort of how I spent the first it was 40 years ago last month that I started TravelX. Prior to that, I'd spent 3 years working in the city. I went there to get as much commercial experience in a shorter time as possible, and for all the wrong reasons. I went there in September 73, and within 3 months, I was getting an absolute baptism of fire. I mean, you're all too young to remember this, but at that time, you had, within a matter of weeks, a quadrupling of the oil price overnight. Just imagine what a sort of economic shock that was to the world. We had miner strikes here in the UK. We had three-day working weeks. You had to look in the newspaper when your area was going to be without power. We had the Middle East war. We had the collapse of the stock market, collapse of the property market, collapse of the government. And as an apprentice working in the city, it was a fascinating time to be involved with what was going on in business. But I always wanted to start my own business, and that was back in 1976. We were coming into 77, the Queen's Silver Jubilee year, lots of tourists due to flock to London. I didn't have any money. I decided I'd open a small money-changing shop in the heart of London, a street called Southampton Road, just near the British Museum. And at that time, you should be aware that firstly there was exchange control in the UK, so we were only allowed to take £50 of currency per person per trip. You had a little white sticky form in the back of your passport, the banks had to mark that. We had exchange control. This world that I was going into was dominated by some of the largest and oldest banks and financial organisations in the world. Tax rates were in the order of 83%, in some cases 98%, and there was already talk of a common European currency. So why you go into a money-changing business, I'm not too sure, but sometimes you can think too hard about these things. And I took this little shop and I borrowed £25,000 and gave away 50% of the business at the time. And I opened this little shop, and for the first 3 months, 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, all there was me. And I used to have to shut the shop to go to the toilet in the hotel next door because there was no toilet in the shop. And my first customer came in to change 300 French francs, if you remember what they were. And you never know, you might see them back again. I mean, I say that normally as a bit of a joke, but perhaps it's not such a joke. Somebody in America, some US guy just said last night or today that, you know, the euro could collapse within 18 months or something. Anyway, and that's how I started the business. And, you know, can I produce for you the sort of 40-year business plan that will show you from bottom left to top right, you know, how this one little shop will become what indeed it became, which was the world's largest retail foreign exchange business. And of course, in the real world of building businesses, that's not how it happened. And over time, this one little shop grew, and, you know, I moved from dealing with the tourist public to dealing with the traveling public. And I built the business through going into seaports and ferries, and then in 1985-86, broke into our first ever airport contract, which was at Heathrow's then brand new Terminal 4. Just so you understand, I had to fight to reverse two refusals just to be allowed to go into the tender to pitch for this contract, because in those days they only appointed the big national banks, the clearing banks. But it was just at the time when the then unprivatized British Airports Authority was just getting into the whole retailing thing, and, you know, the fairy godmother of aspiring business builders shone down that day to find me the right person, the right frame of mind, and this lady allowed me into the tender. And against the odds, we won this contract to be then the exclusive operator in the newest terminal at the biggest international airport in the world, and they only ever appointed national banks. So it was very controversial. Today, you know, the rest, they say, is history. There are no more clearing banks, national banks operating in any airports in the UK. Travelex operates in 125 airports around the world, including 20 of the world's top 30, and something like 43% of the world's airline passengers go through the airport terminals that Travelex operates in. And I broadened the business over that time, and we broadened it away from just retail foreign exchange. We went into payments. Famously in 2001, I bought the Thomas Cook's then financial services business. Thomas Cook in those days had a very big and old established financial services business. They had invented the traveler's check, if you remember what that was. And I bought that business again in an auction that we were specifically barred and excluded from being allowed to participate in because they were our fiercest competitor. But again, I managed to get into that auction, and we ended up buying that business for £440 million. I didn't have the money. We'd never bought a business for £44 million, let alone £440 million. They were four times our size. They hated us, hated me, and they woke up one day to find out that their dreaded enemy was now their boss. So that presented all sorts of management and integration challenges. But it was an amazing deal, not least because we paid for it in we exchanged contracts in November 2000. We completed in March 2001, and by October 2001, 7 months later, we were able to repay the whole £440 million, and we didn't sell any businesses. So it was a good deal. It was a good deal. And really propelled the growth and the expansion of Travelex, and really sort of expanded us, not only in terms of the range of businesses, but also geographically. And it was, in truth, a sort of commercial adventure the like of which I'd never really sort of imagined. And today, you know, I sit with, well, I go around the world and I sit with governors of central banks and finance ministers and prime ministers and presidents, and they all refer to and want Travelex to come and operate in their airports. And I remember a couple of years ago being with one of the senior regulators in Beijing, and he turned around and said to me, "Mr. Dorfman, Travelex, the most famous foreign exchange company in the world." And that was good. And I was trying to persuade him to change the regulations in China to enable Travelex to do things in China, and they did, and they would listen to me. And that was quite nice to know that we had the relationship and the credential to be able to do that. So overall, Travelex was, you know, really challenged the established banks and really took what was for them a niche business and turned it into a global business and a global expertise of its own. But that's just sort of was the first sort of 35 years of my business career. And as I ended up doing a deal with a private equity company back in 2005, and at that point decided to start building and developing other businesses. And I wanted to go and invest in the property business. But, you know, was the property business really waiting for me? And, you know, I came from an operationally intensive background. So to buy commercial properties and collect rent four times a year and wait for five-year rent reviews was all a bit boring. But I started to buy office buildings, and I started to hear about this serviced, flexible office building business. And I got really interested in it. And I ended up meeting a couple of guys who'd started a small business called The Office Group, backed by a private equity company. And to cut a long story short, 6.5 years ago, I bought out the private equity company. And that business, over 6.5 years since we've come together, and I'm the chairman, the majority shareholder, operates now just over 1 million square feet. We have something like 33 buildings. 31 of them are in London. London's actually today the largest market in the world for flexible office space. And, you know, traditionally, I'm sure you're aware that companies would sign 10, 15, 20 year leases. Today, you know, the average length of leases is coming down. People want more flexibility. They want to be able to expand. They want to be able to contract, pay for meeting rooms when they want them. And not only is it flexible office space, but also there's this sort of notion of co-working space. So if you're on your own and you want to work in an office, you can work in a sort of co-working lounge. And as we say, you can work for yourself, but not by yourself. And absolutely, you know, this form of tenure within the property sector, its time has come. And, you know, it used to be, you know, not that long ago, that, you know, a lot of small companies wanted to be near the large ones. But today, a lot of large companies want to be near the small ones. So our client base consists not only of a lot of SMEs and startup companies, but we also have in our buildings the likes of Facebook, Coca-Cola, Disney, Santander, Hootsuite, and the sort of dynamic of large corporates with the small SMEs and also startups creates a tremendous vibe within a lot of our buildings. And it's about building a community, and in our larger buildings we have gyms and we have cafes, and you can sort of sense the vibe that goes on within these buildings. And it's a really, it's a great business model. This business has now become, you know, quite a sizable business. And it's a hot space. And I mean, even, you know, you guys are looking at this foundry and, you know, everyone's getting into it. And it's just interesting to see how the traditional way of taking office space, the way we work, has moved on now to a more flexible and dynamic model. A little bit about Doddle. So Doddle is a startup business, and is in what I best describe as the click and collect space. This was an idea that was actually brought to me originally by Network Rail, who had been looking at their railway stations and to look for ways of how their railway stations could, whose significance as ticket collection points is sort of declining inexorably over time. But there's a railway station at the heart of every town and city in the country, and every day millions of people pass through railway stations. So they were thinking about what could they do to get these railway stations to re-engage with their communities. And one of the areas they started to look at was the whole area of the last mile, as we are seeing this sort of exponential growth of online shopping. And how did they end up, how did they come to me, how did this come to me? The simple answer is that within the flexible office business, we have a joint venture with Network Rail, and we do things at railway station buildings. And through that relationship, they came to know me and then came to talk to me about this click and collect idea. And they wanted somebody to be an independent chairman to lead the business, to give it a life outside of Network Rail, because they knew if it stayed within the infrastructure of a great big Network Rail, it would sort of wither on the vine. And they knew this idea was potentially too good and too important to let that happen. And they wanted somebody who was independent of all the retailers and all the carriers, because they wanted to be open access to all retailers and all carriers, however big or small. They wanted somebody who was experienced in operating an operationally intensive business, somebody that they felt comfortable with, and somebody who would be their partner. And the guys, they met me at a presentation we did in the office group, the first building we did with them, which was actually at Paddington Station, and they came to me with this idea. As I'm sure you know, I mean, online shopping has become a huge phenomenon. The UK is actually one of the most advanced online shopping countries in the world in terms of spend and utilization. But nobody's really cracked the whole challenge of the last mile. Not everyone can be at home to wait to receive things. Everyone dreads the car through the letterbox. And the great insight here was actually to put parcel collection and return shops in railway stations or busy commuter locations, which are part of a journey that millions of people are taking every day anyway. So on your way into, by the way, it's not just about the sensitivity, it's not just about collections, but also about returns, because a lot of people want to return things as well. 63%, the research shows that 63% of online shoppers would shop more if the return process wasn't so ball-breaking. And of course, if you're commuting then, or going through a railway station or live near a railway station, on your way into work, you can return the things you want to return, and on your way home from work, you can collect the things you want to collect. And that's a sort of simplistic idea. In the end, about 18 months ago, I had to buy out Network Rail for complicated reasons, because basically their life is now dominated by the Treasury. And the original business plan, which was to open 300, 400, 600 stores, we've now moved on from that, because click and collect is actually now the fastest element of online shopping. So now it's all about relationships and the technology we've developed, and going into supermarkets and into high street stores and offering click and collect points in those supermarkets and in those stores. So the business model has absolutely evolved on from how it was back sort of 3 years ago when we had the discussion. And it's a very exciting space to be in, because nobody knows quite how it's all going to pan out. Sainsbury's have bought Argos, Amazon are the great big 60,000 ton gorilla that everyone's sort of trying to sort of second guess and compete against. And it's just a really interesting space to be in. It's a startup of a business that's never been done before. And in the spirit, in the way of all startups, it's taking longer and costing more money, but it's in a space that is a very hot space, and we've got a great team, and it's sort of in, so watch this space and you'll see how it develops. But I sort of, apart from being involved in, a foreign exchange business, a flexible office business, this click and collect retail business, I do a number of other things as well. So the theatre goers amongst you, I I came to know Nick Heitner, who was until 2 years ago the artistic director of the National Theatre. I have quite a close relationship with the National Theatre. I was on the board for 9.5 years. He and his number two, Nick Starr, have just set up a new commercial theatre business called the London Theatre Company. And I am one of three main shareholders now, and I'm on the board of this London Theatre Company. And, you know, this is Nick Heitner and Nick Starr. You know, these, you know, if you're going to back any two guys in the theatre business, you know, these are the two guys to back. And it's not just about the operation of the Bridge Theatre, because it's going to be more than this one space. You know, can Nick find another war horse? You know, he's very commercial, very creative. And of course, because it's him, all the hot writers want to write for him and all the hot actors want to act for him. And it's really interesting sitting at the board meetings, and we had one actually yesterday, and hearing how this startup theatre business, and he's, you know, he's out to sort of challenge and move on the whole business of operating theatre, to sort of move it on to a whole next stage. And they're going to announce the sort of first series of shows, I think in April they'll be announcing them. And you know, some very cool stuff, and it's just interesting to see a theatre business get going. I'm also talking to other challenges. I'm a shareholder and on the board of the Ben Ainslie British America's Cup Challenge. This is a business, believe it or not, although I had to explain this to my wife, it was a business. And this, as you may know, the America's Cup is the world's oldest sporting trophy. 1851, the world's oldest sporting trophy, and Britain has never won it once, not once. And the perceived thinking is that if ever there was a time in 165 years that finally Britain might finally win the America's Cup, this year, the final is in Bermuda in May and June, with Ben Ainslie, the British multi-gold medal, Olympic-winning, all-round good guy, sailing hero, will lead us to victory for the first time in 165 years. So watch this space. But again, interesting from a sort of point of view. I mean, this is a challenge in every sense, a challenge from a business point of view, a challenge from a sort of sporting point of view. And if we do it, we'll create sporting history. And if we don't do it, everyone will tell us how stupid we were and we shouldn't have done it in the first place. And just sort of finally on the business things, you know, one of the other businesses that we're a lead investor in has actually been involved backing two bright guys who have basically invented a new form of visual medium, the moving photo, which is being launched under the Polaroid brand as Polaroid Swing. So this is a photograph that moves. And this is a startup business. This is an app that you can download. And again, it's just interesting to see these two young guys who've created this new visual medium and to see how that develops. So, yeah, I lead quite a sort of varied business sort of life. Yeah, I'm not interested in sort of investing in funds. You know, I like to be involved in businesses where we can sort of be involved and we can add value. I like to build businesses, and I particularly like to build challenging businesses. And you know, the common feature with all those companies is they're all challenging their in their respective fields accepted norm of how things have been done previously. But you know, and Peter mentioned briefly, you know, I've sort of one way or another, quite involved in the sort of philanthropic world. You know, I was 9.5 years on the board of the National Theatre. I chair the Prince's Trust. I also chair Prince's Trust International, which is the Prince of Wales. And Prince's Trust is his oldest and largest charity. Prince's Trust International is his newest one, which is a startup. It's all about basically taking Prince's Trust programs and doing this around the world. So I chair that as well. I also am on the board of the Opera House. I'm on the board of the Royal Academy Trust. I do various things within the Jewish community. But just coming back to the theme of challenges, you know, with all these charities, particularly the arts charities, You know, they have the challenge of reducing public subsidy. How do they make up for that? In the case of the Royal Opera House, in the case of the Royal Academy, they've both got £50 million building projects going on. You know, how do they get that funded? What do they do with the space? How do they move their own businesses on? I mean, the National Theatre, you know, where I was on the board for 9.5 years, I saw that grow from being a £50 million theatre business to being a £100 million theatre business. And these are my words, from being a small National Theatre into being a big National Theatre. It was really interesting to see how that happened. So in the philanthropic world, in the charity world, you know, organisations like that have to think about the challenges they face and how they grow to move and evolve their own activities. So, I mean, I think, you know, there are enormous opportunities to be an entrepreneur. Today, you can start a business in your bedroom. Last year, 2016, there were over 600,000 new businesses started in the UK. And of course, as we know, big technology companies have grown quickly and are disrupting markets. Remember that the world's largest taxi company, owns no vehicles. Facebook, which is the world's most popular media owner, creates no content of its own. And Airbnb owns no real estate of its own. And yet they've become huge multi-billion dollar value businesses and have really disrupted the whole sectors that they've grown up in. And drawing all the threads of this together, I wanted to really sort of try and highlight seven themes that I think are out there and messages to to communicate as part of building and growing and developing businesses. I think borrowing a phrase from Steve Covey's bestseller, let's call them the seven habits of highly effective entrepreneurs. So the first one is persistence. As an entrepreneur, you absolutely have to show perseverance, tenacity, and resilience. Be able to respond positively, quickly to setbacks, because they happen in any business. And remember, I don't know if you may be familiar with this, but it's a wonderful quote from US President Calvin Coolidge, who said, "Nothing in this world can take the place of persistence. Talent will not. Nothing is more common than unsuccessful men with talent. Genius will not. Unrewarded genius is almost a proverb. Education will not. The world is full of educated derelicts. Persistence and determination alone are omnipotent. The slogan, press on, has solved and always will solve the problems of the human race." Second message is stick to what you know and who you know, and by and large, you should stay out of trouble. You know, as a young entrepreneur, I decided to set up a currency exchange business, and I'd had some experience of that because my family had a small money-changing business, which I used to have a school holiday job working in. So I had some experience of it. You know, stick to what you know and who you know, and by and large, you should stay out of trouble. Thirdly, conventional thinking will only ever produce conventional results. You know, in today's competitive world, if you're going to think the same as everybody and do the same as everybody else, you'll end up being the same as everybody else. And in today's competitive environment, you need to think of that little something extra that will give you the competitive edge. Fourthly, absolutely the importance of self-belief. You can have all the advisors in the world, and I've been there. You know, you can have rooms full of people giving you all sorts of advice, but as you come to those meaningful challenges, you have to dig deep down and know that this next challenge absolutely, you know, it's right for you to take on. When I was buying Thomas Cook, you know, we had a room full of advisors. You know, I was absolutely betting the business. I'd never paid anything like that sum of money for an acquisition. But I knew if ever I was going to do it, it was for this acquisition and for this opportunity that was the right thing to do. Fifth, change often requires risk, but don't be scared to fail. In my own career, you know, many setbacks, made many mistakes. I mean, you can't be in business and not have a setback and not make a mistake. But as Winston Churchill famously said, success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It's the courage to continue that counts. Sixth, think internationally. You know, we're a global village. I mean, you know, everyone talks about Brexit and the importance of doing things internationally, and absolutely. I mean, you know, in this country, you know, we've been a trading mercantile nation for hundreds of years. It's sort of in our DNA, certainly for those of you who are British. But the world is a small place. And, you know, don't think just in terms of local or national markets. Think beyond, because there's enormous opportunity out there to do many things. And finally, always remember your roots and try to put something back, whether it's time or money. And it was a great scientist, Albert Einstein, who said, quote, "It is every man's obligation to put back into the world at least the equivalent of what he takes out of it." And I think that's a very important notion. So those are my sort of seven tips around being an entrepreneur. But at the end of the day, of course, it needs to be accompanied by hard work and occasionally a little bit of luck. And before I close and take questions, I just thought I'd end with probably my favorite quote, which comes indeed from another US president, Theodore Roosevelt, who really, in these words, for me, sort of encapsulates what it is to be an entrepreneur, to take on risk, to take on challenge. And he said this. He said, "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and who comes short again and again because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends, and who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with the cold and timid souls who knew neither victory nor defeat." Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for coming tonight. Thank you for listening. Thank you.
Yeah. Could introduce yourself and make your question short, that would be great.
Hello, thank you for your sharing. My name is Dennis from the current MBA class.
Yeah.
I think I'm pretty interested in the story about how you breaking in the business in Heathrow Terminal 4. Since Travelex at that time was a relatively small business and your competitors are more established banks. So can you please share with us more about what are the key success factors at that time that Travelex won the business in Heathrow? Thank you.
Okay, so how did Travelex manage to win the contract at Terminal 4 when this world was dominated by, you know, some, I mean, just to put this in perspective, by the way, we, you know, at the time, I employed 40 people in total. When we won the contract for Terminal 4, we needed to employ 70 just to run Terminal 4. So it was sort of a huge step for me. Why did it happen? Because in those days, you know, the big banks felt they had to be the supermarkets of financial services and provide every service, however big or small themselves. You know, not, you know, I'm now post facto sort of justifying it, but I'm sort of, you'll understand. At the time, we decided to focus on a particular small element of one banking service, which actually is not a core part of their own business. It's an ancillary service. And we focused on that one element of banking services and we made it our expertise. And nobody knew more about that business, that element of business, than we did. And if you're a big national bank and you're making 5, 6, 7, 8 billion, whatever it is, a year you're making, are you making it out of providing retail foreign exchange services? No, you're not. Are you putting your best people on it? Are you investing in systems on it? No, you're not. For us, this became our core business. And I sort of draw the analogy sometimes of great big national airline like British Airways, you know, and who, for their short-haul routes, for many years would struggle to break even, let alone make money, out of their short-haul routes, but always thought it was important because they were feeders into the long-haul routes. You take those short-haul routes outside of the infrastructure of a great big national airline and you make them a lean, focused business on its own, and you have low-cost airlines. So you have EasyJet, EasyJet and Ryanair are short-haul route operators, and they now make more money than British Airways. So I suppose it's, you know, focusing on a particular aspect of a big competitor's business, making it your expertise, and, you know, when you're building a business, you don't have to operate with all the expensive infrastructure that a great big business does. So that's sort of how we did it.
Hello, I'm from Dover-Brooks, that school in Oxford. And my question is, what is your advice for young people who are just entering the business industry from universities? Like, how should we respond to this, like, dramatic changes in market and, like, everything?
Well, I mean, I think, look, the opportunity for young people to set up, as I said before, you know, you can set up a business in your bedroom. You know, with technology and a laptop, you know, I think the barriers to entering business today have never been as few as they are. Huge opportunity. Technology has empowered that. You know, I don't know what sort of things interest you, what fields interest you that you want to pursue in business, but, you know, the opportunities have never been bigger, and you absolutely should go for it. And you should decide, you know, what are the areas I'm interested in, where, you know, and look to, I don't know what I can say to you. I mean, just, you know, go build a business, you know. There's nothing stopping you doing it.
Hello, my name is Ben Leslie, and I work here in the careers department.
Yeah,
I'm really interested in your approach to mentoring and coaching of people that have worked for you and now work perhaps alongside you. The pitfalls perhaps you advise them against, or you know, some of your successes for mentoring and some of your failures, what you might have done differently too.
But I've always done things at an early age, so I've always given opportunity to young people. When I started my business, I couldn't afford expensive MBA graduates, you know, so I just needed. I could only afford young, keen people who, you know, wanted to sort of share the dream, and I gave them, in hindsight, enormous responsibility. But it was a fantastic learning opportunity for them. And because I started at a young age, I've never worried about that. And I mean, the chief executive of Travelex today, Anthony Wagerman, is somebody who, you know, I recruited him 15, 16 years ago. He was the head of marketing for a charity. I sort of knew him vaguely. He sort of impressed me. I said to him one day, come and talk to me. I needed somebody to head up marketing and PR for for Travelex. And he thought I was going to try and persuade him to do another job in another charity. And I said, no, I want you to come and do this. And he just, you know, he just caught my eye. And from that, he ended up going into a retail business, learning that. And today, he's the chief executive of running Travelex globally. You know, there are many, many people that I've come across who, you know, who just, I'm terrible at interviewing people because I make my mind up pretty quickly. And, you know, I think I'm just looking for people who are enthusiastic, who care, who want to make a difference. And, you know, I haven't always got it right. You know, but I've come across people who've come from very humble educational backgrounds, who've turned out to be superstars. And I have to say, I've come across very expensive, highly qualified, graduated people who've been completely useless. And, you know, the great thing about education is it sort of develops the mind, it helps you to think. But at the end of the day, you know, it's about common sense, and it's about effort, and it's about looking to make a difference. I don't know what else I can say, really. I'm looking at Zaki, who works for me. But I mean, in terms of mentoring people, I'm quite good at it. Sorry? Yeah, Peter Jackson. Yeah, so the predecessor to Anthony, who was the chief executive, I mean, he was, you know, we were looking to recruit a chief executive for Travelex, and he was 34, but, you know, smart guy, and went to Cambridge, got a first in engineering, went to McKinsey, ended up working for HBOS, became quite senior there. But the thing that I always liked about it was that he was brought up in Leeds, where his father had car showrooms. So he was brought up buying and selling cars. So I thought that was, you know, if you knew how to buy and sell cars, you could sort of, yeah, you could do stuff. He's good. Yeah. Yes, Mohammed.
So I get asked occasionally, and I'm sure you do as well, that to be successful in business, do you need to be lucky or you need to be smart? Or a bit of both? And if you had to choose only one, being lucky or being smart, what would that be?
Definitely lucky. I think Napoleon famously said, you know, don't give me good generals, give me lucky ones. Things like, you know, I found that the harder I worked, the luckier I got. There's all those sorts of things. But As you go through life, as you go through business, you know, as I'm sure you know in your career, you know, stuff happens. You know, stuff happens, and you know, you can't predict it, you can't forecast it, but you know, so many interesting things have happened. You know that, yeah. Well, I was talking about the Thomas Cook. The Thomas Cook acquisition was, you know, one of the, you know, biggest things in my business career and the history of Travelex. You know, we were specifically barred and excluded from being allowed to participate in the auction run by JP Morgan to buy Thomas Cook. And I tried every single way to get into this auction, and every time it came back, no, Travelex, you can't do it. But it so happened that one of the three shareholders of Thomas Cook, two of the shareholders were German. The third one was an American company called Carlson, based in Minneapolis. And the guy who headed up the division in this company in Minneapolis, of all the bars in all the world, happened to be a Brit. And he used to work at British Airways, and I knew him. And he was the guy I spoke to, and I said, Mike, you know, you got to let us into this. And he was the guy that turned around to everybody and said, look, we're running an auction here. The more the merrier. I've known Lloyd. I've seen him build a business. You know, let him into. And here was, you know, through Minneapolis, you know, here was this sort of spooky connection through to this guy who used to work it, and that's sort of how that happened. And you know, throughout my career, and I'm sure, you know, it just, you'll find, you know, stuff happens, and you know, you'll meet one each other at a critical moment, and things will happen. You know, one of the luckiest things that ever happened for us was the introduction of the euro. You know, people used to talk to me about the prospect of the introduction of euro and say, to, you know, look at me like, you know, I should be in mourning. It, you know, once the euro comes, we're finished, it's all over. But you know, sometimes big change can create big opportunity. And our vision with the euro was that we would end up with a larger slice of a smaller cake. And that's exactly what happened. And one of the best things that ever happened for Travelex and for me in the foreign exchange business was the introduction of euro. Wouldn't have been good if the euro had come to the UK, that wouldn't have been good. But the fact that it happened in continental Europe, and that happened. And absolutely, Travelex ended up with a larger slice of a smaller cake. But remember, you know, if you think about it, the size of the cake is the travel market. And if you believe in the long-term exponential growth of travel, more people traveling more often as a sort of macroeconomic fact of life, what begins or began as a larger slice of a smaller cake, over time will become a larger slice of a larger cake. And you know, that was, you know, a great piece of good fortune for Travelex. Yeah.
Perfect segue. Since you're just talking about the euro, given your connections with finance ministers and PMs that you mentioned before, what are your own personal thoughts about the future of the euro? And not analysts that you've spoken to that predict 18 months from now, et cetera?
Well, I think, yeah, I suppose it already rests with Germany. Yeah, basically, whatever they say, Germany underwrites the euro. And, you know, they're all pretty well, I mean, they're all very heavily committed to it. I think, I mean, it had a serious wobble probably, you know, the European banking crisis probably about five years ago. They're still not out of the woods, you know. Greece is never going to be able to pay all that money back, but, you know, my late father-in-law used to have a wonderful expression, which is that I'd rather owe it to you for the rest of my life than catch you for it. And, you know, they'll just carry on owing the money for many years. So I think it will survive, but Germany is the key. You know, I mean, Germany will have to support it. I have no greater insights, you know, but that's my view. Yep. Sorry. Yep.
Hi, Lloyd. Thank you for your engaging and very inspiring talk.
Thank you.
My name is Charles Shi. I'm a horticulturalist. And I'm thinking about starting an international business in my field. I was wondering what advice you would give and what are the main points following on from your success points as an entrepreneur. What would you advise in starting an international business? Thank you.
In horticulture?
In general.
I mean, as I said to you, you know, back there before, I mean, I think you need to decide, you know, a particular aspect of horticulture or whatever business it is, and you need to, you know, look at the opportunities. You know, it's. I think it depends how quickly you want to get started. There's also actually. Yeah, so if you've got the time and the inclination, it's not a bad thing to go and work for a large company for a period of time, because it gives you a bit of experience, particularly of structures, and also about more of an insight into the market of whatever it is you want to do. And you know, at this stage, how old are you?
23.
Okay, so you've got a couple of years you can afford to play around with, and you know, you could go into a large company in whichever field you want to go, understand the market a bit more, and then at the ripe old age of 26 or 27, you know, you could then find some element of that market and then pursue it. I mean, it's you know, it's there's no sort of cast iron guaranteed route that I can prescribe for somebody who wants to go and start a business. And, you know, you just got to go find the area you're interested in, understand it a bit more, and go and do it.
You say it's okay to make mistakes, and if you're going to take risks, you've got to be prepared to make mistakes.
Yeah.
I wonder if one mistake, however spectacular, sticks in your mind that you've made, that you've actually managed to turn around into some positive that's changed you and made you stronger as a businessman.
I'm hesitating. I don't want you to think I've never made mistakes. I absolutely have made lots of mistakes. Funny enough, I think a lot of the most painful mistakes I've made are actually been around people. You know, some initiatives that we've looked to do have turned out to be slower or not as successful as we thought. And you know, I think that Euro was not a mistake, but it was just a good illustration of how a huge threat actually became a great opportunity, and that's, I think, a lesson for everybody. I reminded myself, coming back to Mohammed's story about question about luck, this is a good story just to share with you all. But when we bought Thomas Cook, we had a need to raise the profile of Travelex, to migrate all the Thomas Cook operations over to Travelex. And we didn't have big budgets. And initially we thought we'd do it by way of advertising. But this was a worldwide marketing agenda and how we were going to do this. And we thought, well, we'll do it. This is not quite an answer to your question, but it's a good story. We'd sort of do it by way of advertising. We'd do it by way of in-flight magazines and The Economist and The Wall Street Journal. And with the little money we had, we'd sort of spread it around. So we go to the advertising agency, and they come back with a campaign idea. And the line of the campaign was, you'd notice if we weren't there. And this was, as I said, this was probably February, March 2001. And the line of the campaign was, you'd notice if we weren't there. And they came to present to me one day to show me how they were going to illustrate this line using all sorts of iconic photographic images with something missing. You'd notice if we weren't there. And they laid them all out, and there was Big Ben without the clock. There was the Stars and Stripes flag without the stars. There was the Eiffel Tower up to the second floor. And one of the images, and this goes back to the lucky story, one of the images, I promise you, in February, March 2001, I remember standing over it, was Manhattan without the Twin Towers. Now, you wouldn't have wanted been the company to have run an advertising campaign in March 2001, which featured Manhattan without the Twin Towers. So there is a God, right? and I remember having the debate, and we decided that in the end, for the US market, the Stars and Stripes without the stars was a stronger image than Manhattan without the Twin Towers. So that was sort of, but so these are all sort of, it's just, remember that story, but just, it's sort of, you know, it's difficult to point to any single mistake which had sort of significant consequences. I mean, that sounds terrible. There were lots of things that didn't work as well as I hoped, whatever. But, you know, you just hope to get things right 51% of the time. And I always I always said to say to the guys, you know, you make a mistake, you pick yourself up, you dust yourself off, you know, and you learn from that mistake. You know, don't do it a second time. You know, let's learn from that. But you know, that's how it happens for all of us. I dare say there are even mistakes in business schools. Not many. Not many. Yep.
As far as the challenge of building a challenger business, because my name is Charles Quayle, I'm actually a student of organizational leadership as well as I do have a business of a chain of dental clinics. But the challenge of building a challenger business, what would you say was your greatest challenge in TravelX?
Look, I think, you know, the greatest challenge was it was really trying to build a business at that. You know, the start in a market that was dominated by some of the largest and oldest banks in the world. Our competitors were, you know, the big banks. They were Thomas Cook, which in those days had this huge financial services business. It was American Express. You know, we would set up. You know, I would go into countries to set up TravelX operations, where not only were we facing entrenched competition from very large, established local banks, but often in cases where the regulations didn't allow us to do what we wanted to do. So not only did we have to have the guts to set up the operation in that market, but we then had to go and meet with the regulators to try and change the regulations. So, you know, these are, you know, huge challenges. And, you know, I told the story about the conversation with the regulator in Beijing. You know, when you sit with the regulator and you're trying to explain to them they need to change their regulations because the world is moving on, you know, and then eventually they do, I mean, it takes time, then, you know, that's quite satisfying. So it's you know, it was the challenge of huge entrenched competition, regulation that itself needed to be changed, and it's all the growing pains of building a business. You know, it's, you know, I started the business when I was 24. You know, I didn't go to business school. You know, I didn't know the answers. I didn't know the bloody questions. And, you know, you sort of learn on the job. And I always, you know, prided myself on surrounding myself with people whose opinions I respected. And we would have those discussions and those debates about the way forward, which may not be obvious, and we would tease out the solution, and if the solution wasn't obvious, then I would make the final decision. It was a real David and Goliath story.
Maybe we can take one or two more questions, and then we'll go outside the reception area.
Hi, my name is Hayes Hagen. I'm an undergraduate student at Oxford. And so obviously philanthropy is a very important part of your life. And so my question is, has it always been since you were 24, since day one, or did you become a philanthropist once you found success? And if it's the latter, at what point do you kind of decide, I've made it far enough, it's time to start giving back? How did that play out in your life?
Okay, so. How to answer that? So, firstly, you know, I'm Jewish, so within the Jewish community, you know, philanthropy is quite an important part of the community and what we do. So you sort of become aware of that sort of fairly early on. And I think also today, you know, there's been the, quite a sort of what I would call the democratization of philanthropy. So, you know, there's, the big TV shows, if I say to you Children in Need, does everybody know what I'm talking about? You know, the big TV shows where, you know, everyone at whatever level is encouraged, whether it's school kids or wherever, to send in money. And, you know, that's made people more philanthropically aware. And that's why I said earlier, and I think it's important to give something back at whatever level. I don't think there's a figure that you can say, well, when you get to that figure, then you're time to be a philanthropist, because, you know, there's always somebody that's giving more money anyway. But I think it's you know, when you're in a position, you know, I mean, how many shoes can you wear and how many cars can you drive and how many holidays can you go on? And actually, you know, I'm sure, and I mean, Mohamed Morsi is also another distinguished philanthropist, and you know, I think it's both a you know, it's both a privilege and a pleasure to be able to do that. Very rewarding, and not only giving money, but also giving time. And you know, you sit on these boards in whatever areas you want to be involved in, and these are businesses, you know, it's good, you know, even if they're charities, it's quite helpful if the income exceeds the expenditure. That's a good start, you know, and arts organizations, you know, Prince's Trust, you know, I mean, the Prince's Trust, which I said I chair, I mean, that started 40 years ago. You know, the Prince of Wales started it with £7,500, which was his severance pay when he left the Navy. Today, it's a £70 million charity, and will help 60,000 disadvantaged, vulnerable young people in this country get into some form of education, training, or employment. You know, and the ones who can articulate their story stand up and tell their story, and you know you're changing lives, and you know, it's a fantastic organisation to be involved in. The National Theatre, you know, Travelex did the cheap tickets with Nick Heitner back in starting 2003, and to make the National Theatre more affordable, more accessible. I'm quite keen, and I've said it before, not to over intellectualize philanthropy. You support what you want to support, you do what you want to do. It's not for people to say you should do this or you should do that. But I think it's a very important and also a very rewarding part of, so when you're, you know, as you continue your journey, and you know, I'm sure you'll be a successful business person, you know, you should absolutely look to do stuff. Rick, sorry.
But Lloyd, you and I know each other, as you know, I'm head of Exeter College. But what I wanted to ask you was, when someone like you has been as successful in business as you have been, how do you avoid becoming overconfident? I think of, you know, the dramatic events of the last week, where we have a business person who we're told has been very successful, and who, at least in his public affairs, seems to be a fantasist, virtually. He seems to believe anything he wants to believe. He seems to be supremely overconfident. There must be something about his business life that we don't know. But you seem to have avoided that. But, you know, you've illustrated for us a whole series of triumphs. There must be a temptation when you're sort of four stages on from where you started to believe almost that your instincts are infallible. And how do you keep that from happening? Is it you surround yourself with people who are willing to challenge you?
My wife. So, you know, I've been married 43 years, you know, and last time I did something right, I think, was September 1978. it's sort of funny, but it's also, you know, I mean, I could never do what Trump has done. I'm not sure nobody's ever done it before, have they? I mean, it's an amazing story. Who'd have thought of that a year ago? But, you know, I'd like to think I'm a fairly grounded person, and certainly my wife is, and, you know, our kids are, and, you know, we've got to do some wonderful things, and that's great. But, you know, I don't know how you answer that. I'm life is fallible and we're all fallible, you know, and, you know, it's, you know, my business, you know, in business, it's been a commercial adventure, the like of which I never imagined. And, you know, I'm pleased and proud of the sort of philanthropic things that we do, And you know, but I think responsibly. I'm responsible for a lot of people one way or another. But you know, do I ever think I'm infallible? Absolutely no. And I don't want to go into politics. Probably my wife.
I think that gratitude to our wives is a great place to end. So, but mostly, Lloyd, thank you so much for sharing your wisdom about, you know, these various businesses, you know, what you've done there on so many levels, you know, combinations of luck and perseverance, and some of the best quotes that I think I've heard in a long time. So we all thank Lloyd for joining us today, and then